Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite brother. Had to restart this video. God bless you guys. I've been working on the list of words for people as the Spirit of the Lord has been flowing. And the Lord just arrested me, and he just started speaking to me about the coming judgment. This is an imminent warning of the rapture and an imminent warning of destruction. Now listen, brothers and sisters, those of you who are in the choir, I'm not talking to you, but you know there's tons of people who are running to and fro, trying to figure out when the rapture is going to be. These very shallow-minded people that do not want to be discipled, that do not want to hear the meat of the word and all that, they're the very ones, brothers and sisters, who are going to find themselves left behind. Because in Luke 21:36, the Lord Jesus Christ himself said, when you see, all these things coming, the tribulation and all that, he said, watch and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Don't let anybody try to tell you, brothers and sisters, there's lots of Bible verses, I've done lots of videos on this. Don't let anybody try to tell you, you said a sinner's prayer 20 years ago, you've been living like the devil ever since and some kind of a greasy perversion of the grace of God and think you are going to go in the rapture. Don't believe it, brothers and sisters. To be truly born again, Jesus said you can judge a tree by the fruit it bears. So if you are not bearing fruit of the Spirit, like love and joy and grace and those fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22 and 23, if you're not bearing fruit, what do you do? Do you go to church as an example? Are you to participate in some form of gathering of the saints? The Bible says forsake not the gathering of the saints, especially when you see the end times approaching. That's from Hebrews. And I believe it's chapter 9. Anyway, brothers and sisters, unimportant. It's in the book of Hebrews. So do you pray? Do you read the Bible? It's not that you have to read the Bible every day in order to be saved, that you have to pray every day for 10 hours to be saved. No. But you should bear fruit. Do you have a relationship? To be born again is to have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So therefore, do you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? The Lord is having me start this video by preaching, and I'm going to give the words and stuff that the Lord gave me in a minute. You know why? Because I know those shallow people, the very ones of you who are going to not watch this video, the very ones who are trying to find out the day of the rapture, the very ones running to and fro, you are the very ones that's going to be left behind. Mark my words. Let it be written in Jesus' name, by the grace of God written on your hearts, that you'll remember the day that you're left behind and say, I was not ready. I was not prepared to meet the Lord my God. I was not prepared against the third day. I didn't sanctify myself. For the Bible says, without holiness, no man will see God. The New Testament, Peter quotes from the Old Testament and says, for without holiness, no man shall see God. Psalm 24, who shall ascend to the mountain of God except for he with clean hands and a pure heart? Let me read this word that the Lord gave me. The Lord's giving me more. He keeps dropping it on me. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Deliver unto me fruit in due season, for the enemy is about to come in like a flood on this life. This life, this way of life that we have. You know, in the book of Acts, you know, all these are Bible verses and references to Bible verses from the Lord. In the book of Acts, when the apostles were arrested, the angel of the Lord released them and said, go stand in the temple and tell about this new life. Talking about the church age. So this church age is about to end. This way of life. All things shall be washed away and made new by the blood of the Lamb. I destroy the wise in this world by the word of my mouth. The Lord will do that, the Bible says, at the second coming. Hearken, therefore, to the voice of the Lord your God. I will make you a byword to this stiff-necked people when I take you home to be in my Father's house. That's the rapture. He will use us. They will be, you know, it'll be a saying. All those Christians are gone and we're left behind. Strike the lintels with hyssop covered in blood. It's talking about the Passover. Let every house be covered. For my angel shall pass over this nation, the nation, United States, and destroy the wicked from off the land. I shall devour the land. It's from the Lord. O blood of the Lamb, cover me. Add my name in thy book and exalt thy name in this place. Brothers and sisters, I got more word from the Lord. And the Lord said, the flood is coming. The flood is coming. Just like in the days of Noah, Jesus said, as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Besides about the Nephilim and all those things that I've talked about before, that we've talked about, that sudden destruction is coming and overtake them like a flood. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And they shall not escape, the Apostle Paul tells us. God says through the Apostle Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, He will send them strong delusion that they will believe the lie. What is the lie? The delusion and the lie that you got the Antichrist. Well, guess what the Antichrist and his false prophet is going to be telling people? You can become a god. Take my mark and worship me, and you will be a god. You will be I am. That's the New Age message. That it will be the message of the Antichrist. Take the mark. Become a Nephilim. Become a Giborim. Become an I am. Become a Superman. Become a Spider-Man. Become supernaturally endowed from the DNA of the fallen angels. Brothers and sisters, I'm playing a song, Celebrate Jesus. That's for the church. Guess what, brothers and sisters? Listen to me. Those of you who are going to be raptured, we got to celebrate Jesus. We're going to be there. We're going to be doing one of them Jewish dances. You know, the Lord showed me, you know, how you lock your arms together. And they like it. If you see these movies and stuff of the Jewish wedding and all that, where they lock their arms. Hey, it's a Jewish wedding. I didn't even think about that. That's when I've seen them doing the dance. You know, they lift up the chair in the middle. You know, there's the groom on the chair. All right. And then they go around in a circle. They hook their arms together and they do that. Hey, kicking all that stuff. We're going to be doing that. That's what the Lord showed me. I just realized it's from a wedding. I didn't even think about it. Praise God, brothers and sisters. God is good all the time. Another Don Moen song. God is good all the time. Let's celebrate Him. We're going home, brothers and sisters. We're going home. I came on here being hard because that word is to the backslidden, to the lukewarm. There's many, as I said, who will see this video, warning call, two-minute warning call for the rapture, something like that. I'm going to call it a warning call, warning, rapture imminent. And those people are going to run on here and start watching that because they want to hear, oh, there's a date. Oh, it's going to be on Passover. Oh, it's going to be on Feast of Trumpets and all this stuff. They're trying to count the date, exact day, when it's going to be. Listen, brothers and sisters, it's not when the rapture is, but are you going? Are you prepared to meet the Lord your God? That's the word from the Lord to all people. You know, we have salvation, get born again and all that. But part of being born again, part of the gospel, is that Jesus is coming back to judge the quick and the dead. And there are so many unknowledgeable people in the church, they didn't even know that what the word quicken means, to be the quick and the dead. The living is quicken, is the King James word for living, the quick and the dead. The Lord is coming to judge quick and the dead, brothers and sisters. This is part of the gospel. You know, we have to be ready to meet the Lord our God. Be ready against the third day, for the Lord is coming for His bride without spot, without blemish. Brothers and sisters, get ready, get ready. This is a final warning from the Lord. Listen to me. Destruction is coming. Night is coming when no man can work. There's a flood coming, and they will be overtaken in the flood, and they shall not escape, brothers and sisters. The wicked will be washed away. They'll be washed away into the darkness. What is that? What am I talking about? That's a type and shadow. The flood was a type and a shadow, brothers and sisters, for those people going to hell. They're going to be cast into outer darkness. You know, just the little details of them taking the mark and all that, that ends up being details for eternity. You know, if you're in hell, how did you get here? Did you take the mark? Were you killed in the flood? Were you on drugs when you got killed? Did you deny and say you were atheist? What difference does it make? They're going to be washed away into outer darkness, separated for eternity from God. That's the word. All of that's the thing about it. You know, even though the Lord put me on YouTube to talk all this theology stuff, but to try to get people straightened out with all the false demonic doctrines that's being spouted on YouTube by people who are self-appointed. They're not even ordained ministers. They're not even preachers. Spouting all kinds of stuff. But brothers and sisters, put all the doctrine aside. And just see John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah, they shall not be destroyed in the flood, but be with God in His kingdom. Hallelujah. Call upon the name of the Lord. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now there's people, as I've talked about many times, the man who was a man of fire of God, John Wesley, who founded the now dead denomination, the Methodist Church, in his day, brothers and sisters, helped bring the great awakening to the United States just at the time of the American Revolution. He said there's people that have mental assent. They say in their mind, oh yeah, I believe Jesus died on the cross. Yeah, I believe Jesus was the Son of God. That's totally different, brothers and sisters, than believing with your heart. Confessing with your mouth, as Paul says, Romans 10, 9 and 10. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God is raised him from the dead and thou shalt be saved. So there's tons of people that confess with their mouth, but they don't believe it in their heart. That's the problem with, you know, as I've been talking about evangelism, the sinner's prayer. Give people the gospel and tell them, hey, start talking to the Lord and I'll be here to assist you if you need any help. Start calling on the name of the Lord and talking to him. If they don't know how to talk to Jesus and say, Jesus, forgive me, Jesus, save me, I'm sorry for what I've done. If they can't understand that that's what they need to say, then you didn't give them the gospel. They did not get the gospel from you, and they are not equipped to be saved if they don't understand they need to repent, ask Jesus to forgive them, ask Jesus to save them, ask Jesus to take them to heaven when they die, these kind of things. They should have all of that information in their head and in their heart before they pray. Saying a sinner's prayer is repeating the words that you say up here. This, as a matter of fact, is going from here right out here. It's not going here even to their brain, or much less down to their heart. Go ask a believer. Go ask the average person that's supposed to be a believer. Say, can you lead somebody to the Lord for me? Do a sinner's prayer for me. I bet I could ask half the people who profess to be Christians, can you lead someone in the sinner's prayer? And they could not. So if you are supposed to be saved and you can't lead someone in a sinner's prayer, how is it then that you are saved? Because if you can't articulate, as the Bible says, you know, we should always be prepared. And that's why I always give a lot of Bible verses, brothers and sisters. That's the difference between me and all this other nonsense on YouTube, 90% of it. You got to back it up with Bible verses. And the Bible says, always be prepared to give a defense of the hope that lies within you, Peter told us, by the unction of the Holy Ghost. So if you are not prepared to give a defense of why you believe in Jesus, why you know you're going to heaven and all that, then how is it that you are saved if you can't even articulate what it is that you believe? How is it that you believe it if you don't even have it here? How much less can you have it down here? Now, brothers and sisters, I'm not talking to children and people that just got saved today. Man, it's a little bit difficult. I'm talking about people that's been Christians for, say they've been Christians for, I've been a Christian all my life. Number one, nobody can be a Christian their whole life. There has to be a day when you first believed. You know, and as it says in the song, Amazing Grace, you know, we're no nearer to the end of eternity now than when we first believed. There has to be a day when you first believed, when you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. As they said, as Philip told the eunuch on the way down to, down to Ethiopia, will you believe? And, you know, then you'll be saved. If you believe with all thine heart, you'll be saved. So that's what we have to do. We have to believe with all of our heart to be saved. So there's an hour when we first believe, brothers and sisters, that we can say, I know, you know, there was a moment when the Spirit of the living God bore witness with my spirit that Jesus Christ was Lord. It's not just the words that I heard some preacher saying, like me in a video, when I give John 3:16 or whatever it is. It's not just that words that you heard, because a book is only a book without the power of the Holy Ghost, brothers and sisters. So when you speak the word, it's with power of the Holy Ghost. And that's the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, that takes that word and accomplishes what God would please it to do. God says, my word will not return unto me void, but will accomplish what I please. How does it accomplish it? By the Spirit gives life to the word. It quickens, there's that word, quickens the word of God in our spirits, brothers and sisters. And as I said a million times, if you're not sure if you're saved, don't get up off your knees until you know that you know that you know without a shadow of a doubt that you're saved. If you're not sure that you're born again, I wouldn't sleep tonight until I knew that I was saved. I wouldn't sleep. I wouldn't eat. I wouldn't do anything until I knew that I was saved by the Spirit of God. For the Bible says in Romans 8:16, His Spirit will bear witness with our spirit that we are children of God. I want to know that I know that I know that I'm a child of God. And whenever I have any kind of doubt, I go back to the source of life, the Word and the Spirit. I go back to God's Word. I read His promises again. This is all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If anyone comes to me, I will no wise cast them out, Jesus said in John chapter 2. I believe His Word, hallelujah, where He says, if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I confess those verses. And then I ask, Lord, by His Spirit, Lord, bear witness with my spirit. Lord, I'm feeling unworthy, which I am unworthy, because it's by grace through faith that you're saved. I say, Lord, I'm feeling unworthy. Lord, I had a bad thought today. Lord, I didn't get a chance to pray today. Lord, I didn't read my Bible today. I've been busy, Lord. And I feel bad. I feel unworthy, Lord. Lord, just remind me that I'm one of your children, Lord. Just remind me in my heart, Lord, that you hold me in the palm of your hands, as Jesus said. You know that God holds us in the palm of His hand. Every hair on our head is counted. Hallelujah. God knew us from the foundation of the world. Glory to God. Bless His holy name. Jesus said a bird can't fall to the ground without the Father knowing it. Every hair on our head is counted. As Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, 33, one of the greatest Bible verses in the Bible. In that text, Jesus said, not one of you by worrying can add an inch to your height or change one color of the hair on top of your head. O ye of little faith, but don't you know, seek ye first. Matthew 6:33, probably the greatest word that the Lord gave, in my opinion, to people. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That's what I'm talking about in this video, about righteousness to go to heaven. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all those earthly things you're asking for will be added unto you. You know, and Jesus said, you know, you're worried about your clothes. Raiment is the King James word. You're worried about your clothes. Don't you see how God clothes the flowers of the field and clothes, you know, the lilies of the valley? Like Jesus said, see the lilies of the valley. There, you know, even King Solomon in all of his glorious array wasn't as beautiful as one of these lilies. But those lilies will be, you know, be gone tomorrow and cast into the fire. How much more does God care about you, O ye of little faith? God loves His people. And God wishes none to perish, but all to come to repentance. So there's God's people, born-again Christians, and then Israel. And then there's the world, the Gentile world. God loves sinners, and He wishes none to perish. But I tell you, by the Spirit of the living God, and by the authority of His Word, there is a flood coming. Sudden destruction is coming upon this world, particularly the United States. The hand of God is moving against this nation, says the Lord. And sudden destruction shall overtake this nation. Listen to me, my people, the people of God. Fear not, fear not, fear not. Look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. For I shall deliver you out of the snare of the fowler. In the midnight hour, the voice shall cry out, behold, the bridegroom cometh. And He's coming for those five wise virgins and those five foolish virgins who I always talk to in all of my videos. You five foolish virgins, the same ones who will not listen to discipline and discipleship and rebukes, only want to have their ears tickled with nonsense, Joel Osteen nonsense. You're about to meet the Lord your God. Prepare to meet your Lord your God. Have your oil lamps ready and trimmed and be ready to depart out of this world. For your King cometh at an hour you expect not. Listen to me, an hour you expect not. Even when darkness is falling and you say, oh, there's no rapture. Oh, the Lord has forgotten us. Oh, the Lord, there is no rapture. What's happening? He will come at the midnight hour, at an hour you least expect, an hour you think not. He will show up. And blessed is that servant. Matthew chapter 25, Jesus said, blessed is that servant whom when the master comes, finds him about his business. And that servant, when the master comes, who is drunken and disobedient, that servant will be cast into outer darkness. Jesus said in that text, let him have his place with the hypocrites and the sinners. Brothers and sisters, let these things not be in you, Lord, in you or in me, Lord. Let these things not be, Lord, in us. We praise you, Father, and we love you, Lord. Father, bless your holy name, Lord. Father, we love you, Lord, and I release this word right now into the hearts of men, to the ears of man. I release this word right now in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, the name that's above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess, even Satan, that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. All those people that took the mark, what the great white throne judgment, they still bow the knee and call Jesus Christ Lord. The devil himself will still bow and call Jesus Christ Lord, but yet still be in hell. Bow the knee today or bow the knee then, but you will bow the knee to the Lord Jesus Christ. I've told many people that. I've told my atheist relatives that. This is what I just said. Years ago, I told them that when I first started the ministry. You can either bow your knee now to Jesus, or you can bow your knee to Jesus at the great white throne judgment as you're about to be cast into the lake of fire. But every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, it's all the angels and the heavenly host, and on the earth and things under the earth, even the demons and those who are in hell. And every tongue shall confess, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Go tell the lost that. Bow now or bow then, but you shall bow and call Jesus Christ Lord.